This is GabNet, the Great American Broadcast Network. Talk radio like you've never heard it before.
Hey, everybody. It's Alex Bennett, and it is The Ramble. The Ramble goes from now until midnight on the East Coast of the United States. Right now, it's about 10:05. Here in New York City, and we welcome you and bid you a good evening. A little bit later, we go to the Citizens Panel, which tonight will be without Phil. Phil says he can't make it tonight, so the coast is clear for all you other people who want to get a word in edgewise. In the meantime, you know, it's Thursday night. You know what that means. As they say in most civilized countries of the world, lighten up, everyone. The old Rube is back.
Oh, indeed. It's the most civil thing you can do to greet your friend.
Yes.
Lighten up, everyone. The old Rube is indeed back.
And not just the Rube, but the old Rube.
The old Rube. Yeah. Remember when that was just like a funny thing for a man-child to say, and now it's just true.
Yeah. Oh, boy. Where'd you come up with that, lighten up, everybody, the old Rube? Do you remember when you invented that phrase?
I do, yeah, I do. I was hanging out with Goldthwait one day, and we're sitting there eating ice cream bars and drinking Hawaiian punch. And I said to him, I go, you know, I thought it'd always be funny to walk out on stage and pretend that you're the type of guy that everybody is so happy finally made it. Like, you're the guy that everybody loves to see. But in reality, if they caught you walking down the street, they'd avert their eyes to hope to not make eye contact.
Yeah.
So I said, so I thought it'd be funny to go up on stage and just go, lighten up, everybody. The old Rube's here. You know, like, oh, you got to be happy to see me. And we were just cracking up over that. And I did it, and it stuck. But what it really stuck was about the same time I came up with it was probably like 2 weeks before I did your show for the first time.
Now, you and Goldthwait were pretty tight at one time, right?
At one time, yeah.
Yeah. In fact, you did a lot of things together. There was a
You know, we did a show where it was a funny show. It was at the old Waldorf.
Yeah.
And it was funny because everybody knew his thing was chugging a lot of Tab Cola.
Do you know he finally quit that? He used to do like 2 6-packs a day.
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
And he finally quit, and when he did, he said he just had this ringing in his ears for days.
Wow.
I mean, it was that powerful, that stuff. And Tab, as you remember, was god-awful.
Yeah, it was, man. Yeah. It was.
But anyway, so you were doing a thing at the old Waldorf, right?
Yeah, and this is what was funny. So I was playing a professor... And this is where I think this is a show that he did before I went on your show because nobody knew who I was at the time.
Yeah.
And anyhow, I was playing a professor, and I had a white lab coat on. So he had a rat. He hired a rat wrangler. This woman with her pet rat.
Yes, I remember that.
Yeah, and what I did was I took a shoebox and I cut the corners away.
Yeah.
And just put some tape, one piece of tape, so they could go away. They would fall out really easy.
Yeah.
So then I put the in thing. I got a toy smash rat.
I'm slowly remembering the story. Continue with it. Yeah.
Yeah. I got at a joke store, gag store, like where you can get, you know, fake vomit, stuff like that.
Yeah.
Got the rat, a rat with the guts hanging out of it. And then what I did was I put the rat in the box and I filled it with grapes, hamburger, and ketchup. So then we do a little sketch where you know, Bobcat says, "Yeah, I'm going to find out if I'm going to find out if there's anything bad about drinking Tab, you know, if it causes cancer." So they bring out the rat, like the rat's the one that's been drinking all the Tab.
Yeah.
And it's a real rat, but we swished it really good. Our backs were to the audience. So basically, as she hands me the rat where the audience can see it, and I take it. But then, with her hand down, I handed it right back to her, and I get a foot ladder, a step ladder, and I get up there with a box of tab, a case of tab that was wrapped between two boxes. So it was, and I get up there, and at arm's length, I smash that case of tab down onto that box of meat and grapes and ketchup. And the whole audience freaked out because it looked like I'd smashed the rat. And not only that, pieces of bloody meat and grapes actually hit people in the face. And
it's like a Gallagher concert.
Yeah, that's what it was like. And I tell you, it grossed everybody out. The whole thing backfired on it. People were just like, oh, my God. Oh, my God. So while all this chaos is going on, I pick up the rat and put it under a microscope. And I wait till the noise has died down. And then I say, Bob, you better have a look at this. And he takes a look at it. And I take a look at it. And we both looked at each other and went, cancer.
But as I remember it, the audience wasn't exactly amused.
No, no, they freaked out. There was a story about it in like the LA Times or something about how, you know, Goldthwait went too far or something.
And the rumor went around that he had actually killed a rat.
Right, absolutely, because it looked that good. And yeah, when we delivered the closing line, by that time, boy, man, people hated him. They hated, or they could have hated me, but they didn't know who I was. So yeah, that was good.
That's a good thing about being a never was.
Yeah, yeah,
you know, yeah. And he was just on the cusp of his career beginning big. But you also did a thing for Michael Nesmith, right? You did a.
Well, that was different, man. What happened was. Bobcat was in Hollywood before he moved to Hollywood. And so Michael Nesmith hired him to do a segment in television parts, yeah, which is basically one sketch after another, but not done in front of a live studio audience, just film sketches.
Right.
And pieced together like that, and maybe a short
film. It was based on, he was like one of the first guys ever to do a video. Put out a made-for-video.
Right, right.
And it was called, wasn't called TV Parts, it was called something else, but Elephant Parts.
Elephant Parts, yeah.
Yeah. And this TV show was his entree into doing what he was doing there in right. television. And he was considered a pioneer in video.
Yeah, he was.
Yeah.
Yeah, so, well, the funny thing was, I get a call from Goldthwait, and he said, hey, I'm down here in Hollywood, and I was supposed to do an idea, but I couldn't think of one, so I gave him yours. I hope you don't mind. I told him you have to be in it. I'm like, what the fuck, man? You can't go around giving people my ideas. There's very few of them right now, first of all.
Yeah.
And then...
Now, the idea was a sensational idea.
The idea worked out really well. It was called Houdini the Pig, and it was about escape artist pig. And Goldthwait did a segment called Wild World of Animals.
Mm-hmm.
So he played like a Marlon Perkins character, you know, dressed like in a safari outfit.
Yeah.
But was his usual bobcat self. And then I played the manager of the escape artist pig. And we did a thing. And at the end, the escape artist pig takes a rocket sled across the Grand Canyon. That was pretty funny. But what we did the Chinese water torture thing, mm-hmm, where you have to escape from that tank of water.
Yeah, yeah.
And what was funny was they got a little person to go inside of a burlap bag and then dropped him in the water. And, and he was struggling to make it look like the pig was moving around.
Right.
And the funny thing was they had two guys in swimsuits on set. They had a guy there from the fire department, and you know, let's say the guy's name was Ricky. It was just they dropped Ricky in the water, and you see him struggling in his burlap sack, and then they hoist him out, put him on his tabletop, take him out of the bag and the burlap sack, and then he's soaking wet. But it was just like a classic Hollywood moment where the director goes, "How about a hand for Ricky? Wasn't he wonderful?" And all he did was struggle in a burlap sack.
Well, I remember that you did that Houdini the Pig, and it was a very funny routine. But the thing I remember most was Goldthwait did something, and I want to now confirm whether it's true. The pigs will eat anything. They just gobble anything up. They'll gobble human beings up, oddly enough. They've been known to do that.
Yeah.
He said he was feeding him bacon. Do you know that to be true?
I don't know if that was true or not, but he probably could have been. You know what's funny? When we were doing the filming, I think it was 2 days, and we had this dressing room, and it looked like a motel, like a you know, every door facing the sidewalk, like a Howard Johnson or something.
Yeah,
and I opened our door up just to let some air in, and I go, "Holy shit, there's Richard Pryor!" Richard Pryor was leaning up against the car in the parking lot, and I'm like freaked out, right? You know, oh man, Richard Pryor, gee, I don't know what to say to him. You know, like I was like a giddy little schoolgirl, and and Goldthwait, his only reaction was, "Oh, Richard, I better go say hi." I'm like, "You better go say hi. You don't know Richard Pryor. What the fuck's going on here?" So I walk out with Bobcat, and we walk up to Richard Pryor, and you know, Richard Pryor could have been high as a kite looking back on it, but Goldthwait says to him, "Hi, Richard," and he looks at him, doesn't say anything. He goes, "My name's Bobcat Goldthwait," and Pryor goes, "Uh huh." He goes, "Well, your manager came to see me at a show recently, a showcase," and he goes, "Uh-huh." And then Goldthwait goes, "Well, anyhow, I just wanted to say hi." And Richard Pryor goes, "Uh-huh." And then Goldthwait walked around, and you could just see him getting smaller and smaller as he walked back to the dressing room. Man. It was, as they say, quite the humbling experience.
Yes, absolutely. So he was going to amaze you, though. He was, you know, he was going to go over and have a discussion with Richard Pryor. He was going to hang with Richard, and instead, he just got shined off.
Yeah, shined on, man. It was very funny to me because I gave him a hard time about it when I walked back to the room.
Now, my question. Now, so your association with Goldthwait was, as I remember it, very close, very symbiotic. You came up with stuff together, you know.
We did a funny thing on your show together called Floyd the Rock Opera.
I vaguely remember that, but
that was fun. It was fun. We did a parody of
Tommy,
yeah, and it was about a pinball playing dog named Floyd, and we had lines in there like that gravy sucking canine sure plays a mean pinball.
Why it seems like you were somehow in all these things besmitten by animals, a pig, a rat, a dog who plays pinball.
Absolutely.
Is there something funny to you about animals that fails to?
I think it's funny when you're giving them when you animate them, you know, whatever that word's called.
Yeah.
When you give them a human...
When you anthropomize them.
Yeah,
I'm trying to pronounce the word.
I think that's right, anthropomize them. When you do that, I always thought that was funny, even as a little kid, you know?
Yeah.
So I do a lot of that. I'm trying to think if I still do that. I don't think I've got any animals in my act anymore.
Really?
Yeah, I remember that joke about I quit smoking because I was tired of hacking and wheezing, and one morning I woke up and I coughed up a small wolverine named Mitchell.
Yeah, see, I mean that's a good example. Anthropomize them, but you also I'm not pronouncing it right, but anyway, you not only give them human qualities, but you give them a human name.
Right, right.
Houdini the pig. You know.
Yeah.
What was the pinball wizard brat? You know.
He was just Floyd, the Yahtzee playing dog.
The Yahtzee playing dog.
We had one segment where we'd go back and forth, and he went, "See me," and I went, "Feel me," and he went, "Touch me," and I said, "Heal."
It's a dog.
Instead, of course, heal me, which
yeah,
is that.
Right.
But I remember, too, the audience was packed that day, and that Floyd the Rock opera really went over big.
Yeah. So do you ever hear from Goldthwait?
Oh, that guy. No, I send him, he doesn't return my emails anymore, so I guess.
He really, he doesn't?
No, he doesn't, so I guess I'm too small for him now.
Well, he's not that big.
That's true, but maybe people do things to help them think they're big. I don't know.
Yeah. It's the pictures that got small. I don't know what happened with Bob, but, you know, we were all very close to Bob. We were all close to each other.
Yeah.
And he just, at one point, he decided at one point he hated me. And just started going out after me. Yeah.
What? I don't remember that. What do you mean?
Well, he did a. He came back to San Francisco and he was doing one of those comedy half hours for HBO.
Oh, okay.
And I was introducing the acts, at least in the theater. I didn't do it on the show, but nobody ever saw me introduce them. But I would introduce the acts. I was getting paid by HBO to do that. And I also hosted the show and made sure, you know, I'm down there on the credits as a consultant. And in the first series, I was actually in HBO's One Night Stands. I was the announcer. But anyway, he comes to San Francisco to do one of these things. And so I'm backstage and I'm going to introduce Goldthwait. And I haven't seen him yet because he's been in his dressing room, you know. And so all of a sudden, here he is. He's at the side of the stage with me. And yeah. Hey, Alex, great to see you. How you been? Blah, blah, blah. You're nice as pie. Okay. And I said, yeah, good. Well, we'll have to talk later. Yeah, fine. Terrific. And I go out and I introduce him. And he goes out on stage and they start taping this one night stand. And the first 10 minutes of his act is him saying, what a terrible person I am.
What?
And how he hates me and making fun of me and putting me down. Something they eventually had to cut out of the HBO special because nobody knew who the fuck I was outside of San Francisco.
Wow, man, that's weird.
And I could never for the life of me figure it out because at no point did we ever have a bad word with each other.
It's weird, man. Plus, all the people in the audience must not have liked it because they're your fans, too.
Yeah, yeah. But he literally spent 10 minutes of valuable TV time putting me down. And I'm going, what did I ever do to him? You know, and I was talking the other day to Bubs about this because somebody else has kind of been that way lately with me. And I think that when I had anything to do, sometimes when you have something to do with somebody's success in their career, they either take it one of two ways. They're very thankful and thank you. Patton Oswalt called me one day years ago. He was in San Francisco to do an HBO special. And he says, I want to thank you because I wouldn't be doing a special like this if it weren't for you. Great. Thank you, Patton. I love you. You know, that's very nice of you. You didn't have to do it, but you did it. But then there's the other people who resent the fact that you may have had something to do with making their career.
Yeah.
And I think that's where it was coming from with Goldthwait, that he, you know, I mean, because I was very instrumental in him getting known and getting a popularity and a base. And we were good for each other because he did shows for me and I made money off of him. It was both ways. But I never did anything terrible to him. I never screwed him on a business deal or ever had a harsh word against him. I only wished him the best, you know, in his career.
Man. Yeah, I don't know what the trip is. I don't know, you know. I've always thanked you for allowing me to have a taste of coming so close to your dream you can feel it. But it never actually worked out.
I was glad that I was actually happy to make you feel that miserable. You know, I wanted you to have that taste of fame so that you could know what it was like and know that it's never going to be yours.
Right, right.
Yeah.
It's like, you know what it's like to come this close to your dream, but then it passes you by?
But, you know, as it turned out, Goldthwait's career has been rather mediocre, you know? I mean, he hasn't done anything overwhelmingly big, you know?
Well, he gets to make, excuse me, a little off my game today.
Yeah.
I had trouble sleeping, and then I've been under a lot of stress lately because, you know, we are doing the special, which is great. We reached our goal, and...
Did you reach the? Did you get the eighth? I didn't look lately. Did you reach the 8,500?
Yeah, we got to 9,100.
Oh, good. And yeah. By the way, Patton did about $2,000 of that.
He did $2,000, and then he made a wonderful post on Facebook. Mm-hmm. It was just glowing. It's like, it's nice to read, but I read it and I'm like, I can't live up to this.
He's genuinely one of the really nice guys.
Yeah, and the post, yeah. You know, people from his page started donating to my,
yeah,
you know, people that follow his page started donating, because it was such a wonderful post, and he said, you know, this has got to happen. And he goes, doing his first special, this should be his 20th special, and that's what's wrong with Hollywood, but that, if I went into that, it'd be a 100,000-word essay right now, so. Yeah, all systems to go, man.
Very nice, and I hope we helped a little bit by plugging it on our.
Oh, absolutely!
Thing here.
Yeah,
and
yeah, everybody helped out. I mean, a lot of people donated. Yeah. I think there were like 80 different donations.
Yeah, that's gonna be a long credit roll.
Yeah, everybody gets into credits, man.
Yeah,
I said I wanted to make it the longest credit roll in the history of television. I should just have thousands of people donate $20 would have made me happy, but. Well, we have 80 people to put in the credits.
Yeah, I can see the opening now. Hey, ladies and gentlemen, Bob Rubin. And then you come out and go, thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Now here are the credits. And that goes for a half hour.
Yeah. You know, what I wanted to do is, you know, especially because this is my first special, although I'm not doing it because I got we're doing a sketch before. That you'll see before the special and another one that goes with it at the end of the special, basically about a guy that escaped from a mental institution, then turned himself back in because he realized it's more crazy out there than it is in here, you know.
And, yeah.
But I thought it'd be funny to do one of those standard things where they show a comedian walking to the show, you know, and then they show him back in the dressing room, and then the guy comes in and says 5 minutes, and they just show him being by himself, like getting ready to do battle.
Mm-hmm.
And then they introduce him and he walks out on stage. So I thought it would have been funny to have done that. But the guy that you follow in the backstage stuff isn't me. Since nobody knows who I look like anyhow. And then I come out as Bob Rubin. They'll go, what the fuck was that?
Well, listen, let me ask you. So when is it going to be? When are you going to shoot it?
April 29th.
Yeah, and where is it if people are listening from San Francisco? And I know a lot of people listen to this who are my old fans.
Yeah, it's at Doc's Lab in San Francisco, and the show starts at 9.
Doc's what is it called?
Doc's Lab. It's the old Purple Onion.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it's on Columbus Street, and it's a great place. And if people want to go, just come by, man. There'll be tickets at the door, and it starts at 9 o'clock.
Yeah, you're only doing one show?
Doing one show, I'm going to be doing a longer set than usual. Well, I guess that all depends on how many times you see me before. Some sets have been brutally long.
Well, I would go long because some stuff might not work that night.
Oh, yeah, we want to tighten it up. So I'm going to do about 70 minutes so we can have 15 to cut out.
Yeah, yeah. Wow. Well, I wish you a lot of luck. I wish I could be there for it. But
I wish you could be there too, man. That'd be great.
Yeah. The 29th. What am I doing on the 29th? Nothing, but I'm stuck here in New York. So what can I say?
Well, you know what's funny is I'm glad we went past our goal, though, because GoFundMe takes a healthy cut.
Do they? How much do they take?
Well, I actually made $7,800. So that's like almost 15%, I think.
Wow. Well,
I had 91 and they're taking 1,300.
Okay. So, but that's enough for you to produce the special, right?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Okay, good. Cool. Hey, well, listen, you know, I we had a little trouble getting you today because you overslept. So
I overslept. Yeah. I'm sorry, man. I apologize. I did a warm-up show last night in Venice Beach, and then when I came back, I couldn't sleep. So I was goofing around on the internet, and then I put on a movie and finally fell asleep probably at probably around 5 o'clock.
Oh, and then, yeah. Well, anyway, we'll talk again next week. We'll do another one of these.
I'd like to do another one.
And I'm so happy you reached your goal. And
I think this one went really well, by the way.
This little discussion today?
Yeah, I think it was a good one.
I think it was a very good one.
Helped clear the air on a lot of issues, important ones.
Ladies and gentlemen, the old Rube, yes, has been back. Thanks, Bob.
Thanks, Alex. Bye.
And that's our old friend Bob Rubin, ladies and gentlemen. And here I am, and we are ready to go with everything else. Let me just once again, let me turn on the. It'd be good if I turned on the phones. That would be appropriate. Okay. And give me a call. I need as many callers as possible because Phil isn't calling, and you know he counts as five people. Give me a call tonight. I just want to remind you, Bob Rubin is at Doc's Lab, which is the old Ann's 440, I think, in San Francisco. He's taping this special on Saturday night. And if you already gave him money to do it, you can get in for free, right? You know, you automatically get a ticket to it. So if you can, go to, if you're in San Francisco, go down there and give them all your support that you possibly can, which is basically laughing a lot so the soundtrack sounds good. Anyway, here comes Scott Boddicker, ladies and gentlemen. Hello, Scott. Boy, Scott. Wait a minute. Let me go over to Scott here, and you can see that he's there. He is
fixing his light. Can you see me?
Yeah, you fixed your light.
Okay, camera's on. Camera's on.
Your camera's on. Testing 1, 2, 3. Okay. Testing 1, 2, 3.
Thought I'd call in quick so I didn't have to hear you complain about nobody calling in again.
Well, no, I always complain about it. And then by the end of the show, you know, we have like a full house and I'm going, what was I complaining about? You know,
yeah, exactly.
Yeah, well, it's because I complain. I'm a complainer.
I know you're, you know, but I just don't like listening to it.
You know, somebody said something to me the other day. I think it was Bubs when I was talking to him. I don't know if we said this on the air, but I know we said it off the air. He said, as I get older, I begin to realize why old people are cranky.
You said it online. You said it on the radio, yeah, or the internet, or whatever the hell we're on.
That was his observation, and he's absolutely right. I understand why people are grouchy. Because, like, I got this knee thing, you know, and so I'm going around, and when girlfriend says something to me, I go, yeah, what? What? You know? Because I'm in a little bit of pain, you know. So all these little aches and pains and things like that, you get grouchy, and that's where the grouchy old man comes from. It's just the angriness of nature making you age.
God, I was listening to Jack and Amy last night on their show. Did you listen to that?
No, a little bit.
Oh yeah. Jeez, they were going at it so bad, I had to shut it off. I was like getting upset.
They were cranky with each other.
Yeah, they were arguing about pregnancies and kids.
Well,
and
you know,
whatnot.
The trouble is, I got to say this about Amy. She's a female chauvinist. Really? You know, I mean, guys do this and guys do that. I don't know why she even married one, you know, but the guys do this and guys do that. And I got to tell you, you know, for the most part, it's always been my feeling that guys are okay. You know, most guys are okay.
We're pigs, man. Huh? What are you talking
about?
No,
we're not pigs. We're not pigs. No.
We're sex crazy pigs.
I think we're a lot nicer than women give us credit for.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and I just have always felt that whole idea that we're dogs and we're pigs and we're animals and all of that is something that they throw out there so that they have some argument against us. They can use it against us.
I think there's good standing for some of it.
Well, some guys are assholes. Some women are. Hey, Kate, well, you probably didn't have a large dating life, right? You sound like the guy who got married and that's it, right?
Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah. So anyway, I came up with this, you know, I mean, I have had some women in my life who were the worst human beings you can possibly imagine and treated me horribly.
Do you have any idea of how many women you have dated in your life?
Dated? Or
sex?
There's a difference between dated and sex. You know, with sex, you know, you had sex with them, and then maybe you never had sex again with them, or maybe they became like a fuck buddy or whatever. And then there are people you dated. These are people you went out to with dinner and things like that, you know.
And had sex with.
And then had sex with. So which number do you want?
Just a ballpark.
I never counted.
Over 100.
You're saying over 100. Yes, over 100.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow, I'm impressed.
Keep going.
That's where Amy and some people might, you know. Of course, Amy sounds like she's been around too a little bit.
Well, you know,
she's dated a few, from the story she says, it's self-admitted. I know nothing about her, but yeah.
Yeah, well, I have gone to bed with, you know, I never counted, okay?
Yeah.
I stopped counting after the first 100. I think it probably, it could be a couple of hundred to more than that.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. And I'm not bragging when I say that.
I'm just curious.
Yeah.
You know?
I mean, I don't know. I it would be very hard for me to throw out a ballpark here.
Can you remember most of them?
Can I remember most of them?
Yeah.
Most of them. Yeah. You know, I mean, I can't, if you ask me to sit here and start listening.
You probably can't name their names, but, you know.
It told me to start listening to them. They're, you know, I did have sex with her. That would probably be my answer.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
So, but I don't know. I mean, Amy would think, oh, well, he's a pig. He went to bed with several hundred women. But I got to tell you, most of them stayed my friends, or most of them liked me, or most of them never had anything bad to say about that encounter. It might have been just one time we had sex. Might have been one time we had sex, and the rest of the time, for the rest of our lives, we were friends, you know? But, I mean, I think I treated women pretty well, and I was good to them, and I was nice to them, and I always treated them, I was always a gentleman. Because my father always taught me that, be a gentleman, you know? And so... whatever.
I'm just curious. From the stories. I mean, it sounds like you've had a life of many, many
pleasures.
Well,
let me put it this way. When I was a kid, I was not, how can I call it, the kind of guy women would go after. All right? There were two things that happened in my life. One thing that happened was... I went into radio, and when I went on the radio and I suddenly got popular on the radio, women started chasing me. All of a sudden, I was attractive, and I never had that before. And then when I came to New York, on top of that, I was Jewish, and Jewish males are highly attractive to women in New York. So between those things, a lot. I mean, I could go to a place. There was a place called Plato's Retreat, which had sex. It was a sex place where people went and had orgies, right? I'd go in there and come out of there having had sex with about 7-8 women. So, you know, that's how I got the number up.
You've been there for I didn't know. Yeah.
I
know you did like shows there in your blue thing or whatever.
Midnight Blue.
Midnight Blue.
Well, one time we had the spermathon, and it was one woman to see how many guys she could have sex with in a night.
Did you get in line with it?
No, I didn't.
Hell no.
That's the kind of train you don't want to be the caboose on. Is anybody going to call us tonight?
This is Connection. We're doing a Connection show here.
Yeah,
what's the name of this? Living Sexy, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, this is what they talk about. I lived it, you know. So.
I can't stay up that late to listen.
I would like to say that I was...
ahead of your time?
No.
Or just after?
No, and then I did Midnight Blue, which was a show about sex. So, of course, there was even more sex that I got as a result of that. I combined the two things I like to do in life, broadcasting and sex, you know. So that added to it.
All right. And, great. I'm impressed.
Well, but Amy would call me a male chauvinist pig for that. She would think it was terrible, you know. And the fact is that I was always I have to say this. I mean, I want to be. Wait a minute. What happened to? Oh, hello, John. You there?
Oh yeah. Yeah. I'm here. Looks like you need extra people. So I
don't know. Now, John.
Not sure I can get safe the whole time.
John worked with me at Midnight Blue. He was. The guy who was in charge of transpiration.
And editing anything that Alex didn't want to edit, basically.
Oh, that's right. Misspelled transportation. That's right.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. And so he would be able to tell you about my sex life. He saw it going on all the time, right?
Yeah, but not that I was keeping score.
No, you weren't keeping score, but you saw that there was a lot of activity.
My sex life is like the exact opposite of his. As in, I don't know, you know, how I could probably count. You know, one or two hands, maybe.
Now that's amazing because you know John was he worked, for instance, you worked with Rod Swenson editing his tapes for
Wendy O. Williams and the Plasmatics.
No, but before that, the sex tapes that they used to run at the theater on near 42nd Street.
Well, one of the things about Midnight Blue is we saw a lot, but because we were doing the recording, we didn't do any of it. We watched.
Yeah.
We recorded and we went home.
On one occasion, I got to tell you this. On one occasion, Bruce David, God bless him, he's dead now. And he and I created Midnight Blue together. And he was supposed to come over and interview, what was her name? Tuppy Owens, the world's foremost cocksucker, I think is how she billed herself. And he didn't show up. And here I am with Tuppy Owens just passing the time away saying, hey, he'll be here in a minute. And finally I get a call and he says, I can't make it. And I said, well, I got to do something. So I decided I would interview her from behind the camera. And at one point in the interview, she says, and I am the best cocksucker in the world. And I said,
Prove it.
Pretty much, yeah.
And I'm holding the camera and she goes down on me.
Mm.
And so I shoot it so it's like her forehead because I can't show this on cable, right? But I can show the head bobbing up and down, you know.
Oh, yeah.
And so that's how we did it. And I have to say that I was really proud of myself that day because I managed to have an orgasm and the camera stayed rock solid. I think that's professionalism, okay? But I remember that. And the thing was, we had that tape. And I took a couple of shots of her actually doing it, so I would have it for my, you know,
You edit out the.
Yeah, I would edit that out, but I would have the tape anyway, so that I could, you know, remember the good old days, right?
It's the retrospective, you know.
Al Goldstein, who was financing Midnight Blue, kept trying to lay his hands on that tape, and I told him, "I've got it. You're never getting it." He says, "I'll give you $1,000 for it." Said, no way. And this one, $1,000 was a lot of money. He says, $2,000. I mean, he was willing to pay, I think, up to $5,000 for the tape. And then he was going to hire somebody to go to my apartment and steal it. And I said, no, I literally put it somewhere. I don't even know where it is now. That's how hidden it is.
It could be back at the old apartment down in the village. You know?
Yes, it could. It could. Right. It could have been that what's his name, the subway shooter. Moved into my apartment, and who knows, he may have had the tape. I mean, that's what made him go crazy and start shooting people in the subway. what was his name again? I forget his name.
I'm trying to remember too because I now know somebody, a place that I go to in on 86th Street. The people who own it are good friends with him, and he shows up about three times a year.
Oh, really?
And hangs out.
Yeah.
Now he's into legalizing marijuana, and he's in trouble with his landlord.
He got arrested for selling it.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, that's part of it.
Yeah.
He also is in trouble with his landlord because he is making friends with the local squirrels that will come in and hang out in his apartment. Yeah, you know, so it's like, okay. You
know? What was his name?
I know. I mean, it's blocked.
I'll remember it. I can look it
Subway
up.
Subway Vigilante, right.
Subway Vigilante.
It's not the Bernard Goetz guy.
That's the name. Yeah, that's the name. Bernard Goetz.
Bernie Goetz.
Yeah, whatever Bernie wants, Bernie Goetz. Right.
In fact, I was talking to him about Bernie, and because I said that, you know, something about you and the possibility that was probably the apartment that, because you moved out about the time he moved in, and then he said we were talking about cable and we talked about the at the time recently deceased Coca Crystal. Mm-hmm. And I said, oh yes, we used to see her all the time, and Alex was, you know that sort of thing. So
yeah.
We're talking about all the old cable classics.
Yeah.
How we foisted Ugly George into the world, unfortunately, I think. I don't think he would have gotten into cable that quickly, except that we did that show on him, and he was so, thought it was so great. You know, it's like, hey, maybe I should have a cable show. At least that's what I thought.
Yeah, he was going around. Hi, Rob. Turn on your camera so we can see you. Are you there?
Yep, I'm here.
Yeah, he's there. Yeah.
Ugly George. Ugly George. Well, Ugly George.
Ugly George was this guy that I found who would go around and find women and then tape them having sex with him in alleys and so on.
Ugly George.
Ugly George.
You found him, Alex.
I discovered him.
No kidding.
Yeah, I discovered him. And I actually, you know, I will say I'm very proud of Midnight Blue. I'm very proud of all the things I did sexually and otherwise in Midnight Blue. The thing I regret is Ugly George.
Yeah.
Why?
To begin with.
Me too.
If you may remember, John, you went on. Did you go on that shoot with me with him?
I did. I was at.
Do you remember that he had some
on the street? He couldn't pick anybody up.
He couldn't pick anybody up. He had a guy he knew who went out and brought women back.
Mm-hmm. Then I think he had somebody come in who was like an old girlfriend or something, right? Or something. So at least it looked like there was a woman that was going to at least do something with him, you know. And that was the first time
he had been seen on cable. And then he decided to do a cable show and started going around wearing, I don't know, was it aluminum clothing and stuff?
Oh, yeah. He looked like a spaceman almost. He got video equipment and put it in like with like foil around it or something.
And his whole bit was he would go down the street and would meet up with women and he would convince them to have sex with him.
Yep.
That was the whole show. Huh?
And film it.
Yeah. But it had to be soft core for cable. You couldn't do the hardcore thing. But he still was doing it.
And ostensibly, he was doing it initially before cable to make hardcore films that, you know, films that he could sell, I guess.
Yeah,
You know, but obviously he couldn't do that and be on cable. You have to.
Right.
I think I may have watched half of one of his shows once I moved into Manhattan.
Yeah.
Back in the 80s and the early 90s, I think about. And I was just like, ugh, you know, thank you. Glad I wasn't watching this all the time.
Yeah. But I was always very proud of Midnight Blue because Midnight Blue, I think, had a certain class to it. You know, it was a show about sex. But we I think presented it in a very intelligent way,
and it wasn't, not everything had TNA in it. I mean, there were we did interviews, we did rock videos before there was an MTV.
Yeah,
we did. We did video centerfolds around the time the Playboy Channel started up. We couldn't convince them to have us, you know, do videos for them. They, you know, like, I remember we talked about that.
Well, you know what's strange? I called them video centerfolds. Mm-hmm. Now, get this. Playboy, when they finally started the Playboy Channel, did what they called video centerfolds, and I should have sued them. I'll tell you why. This is interesting. What do they call that centerfold in the middle of Playboy magazine? What did the company itself call them?
The fold-out?
Gatefold.
The gatefold.
Gatefold.
Exactly. Right. They never they never called it the centerfold. I came up with the term centerfold for this, you know, the video centerfolds. So when they went to television, they didn't call it a video gatefold. They called it a video centerfold. Ah, yes. Now, what we do is I would put stuff to music in interesting situations, and a woman writhing around on a bed, you know.
With and without clothes, usually without clothes by the end of it.
And we would do them interestingly. Like, we went into a pinball parlor once, and I had her making love to a pinball machine, sucking on the plunger, you know, things like that. She wasn't fucking the pinball machine.
What year were you doing these?
77, 78,
yeah,
76.
Yeah.
Mid-70s.
They hated us over Manhattan Cable.
Ooh.
Oh, geez. They finally found a way to get us off the air. And believe it or not, my proudest moment, I think, if I have a proud moment in this business of show, was the fact that they held a meeting in Hedley Donovan's office. He was the head of Time Life at the time, and he was very top floor of the building. They actually had a meeting in which they discussed what to do about Midnight Blue. And I knew this because I knew the lawyer for them, and he became a friend of mine, and he would tell me what was going on. And he said, so they had this meeting, and Hedley Donovan said, I want them off the air. They're an embarrassment to Time Life. And the thing was, they couldn't take our show off technically, because we were allowed to exist as long as we weren't doing anything illegal by city statute for what they call public access.
Yeah,
and he said, kick them, take them off the air. And he said, the lawyer I knew said, I told him, you can't do that. You know, we have a deal with the city. And he said, I don't care. Do it, and we'll fight it later. And so they took us off the air, you know. And it was amazing. It was just an amazing thing that happened with us being taken off the air. We went to Time Warner, or Time Life as it was at the time, to have a powwow with them. And as we went in, there were people for Time Life who were picketing against Time Life. There was a strike going on. And so we were walking into the building. My father told me, never walk across a picket line. But I've got to go in there to do battle with them, right? And so as I'm going in, people start yelling, don't do business with Time Life. Don't go in there. Don't go in there. And I yelled back at them, I'm going in there to screw them. And they went, oh, okay, go ahead.
Exactly.
Bunch of Zeke Heil motherfuckers.
Yeah. The idea that they talked about me and my project and my situation at the highest pinnacle of Time Life was amazing to me, because this is a corporation that has a lot of better things to do with their life, you know. Yeah.
And there weren't that many people that actually were able to see this. It was really just in Manhattan.
Yeah.
Not in the other four boroughs or anywhere else, unless you had a videotape recorder, which very few people had at that time. We heard that there were people that were recording this. I think, was it famous that the ABC news guy Roger Grimsby supposedly had recorded this and sent copies of some of the Midnight Blue out to friends of his
really?
On the West Coast.
Really?
I remember something about it.
Did you go to Washington with me?
No, I didn't do that. I missed that. I came in right about after you. I really didn't start doing full-time stuff for you until like mid-76, late 76.
There was a sleazebag of a politician by the name of John Murphy, who was the congressman for Staten Island.
Who I think just passed away. Well, remember, I mentioned that to you a while back, and you said, okay, good riddance.
Good riddance. He, to begin with, was mobbed up like crazy. And in fact, in later years, because the Bennett curse had fallen upon him, got thrown out of Congress because of malfeasance of office. But he decided he was going to go after the filth on cable in New York City, you know? So they had what they called Midnight Blue Day on Capitol Hill. And these people testified about it. And I prevailed upon the committee to let me speak. And so there I was speaking to a congressional committee, you know? What a great day that was. I found out something that day, though. Don't mean shit to a tree, because the guy who was the head of the thing was a guy by the name of John Van Dierlin. And he was the chairman of the committee. It was a House subcommittee on telecommunications.
Right.
Okay. And he was the one who let me speak. He sponsored me, because he said it's only fair that you get to speak to us. So we made up a little tape that we played for them there. So they all go down the hall, and we go into this room, we play this tape. It's a little short tape of just bits and pieces of Midnight Blue, one of which was a gay review of guys butt naked, penises swinging around to the song Babyface. Remember Babyface?
Babyface. The disco face, version.
The disco version. And as we're going back into the hearing room, Van Dierlin sidles up to me and he says, "Hey, kid, that was really funny." He said, "That was incredible. Funny, funny stuff." I said, "Well, thank you, sir." We go back in. I sit down in my place at the table, and they're sitting up there on their, you know, their dais. And he looks down at me and goes, "That's some of the filthiest stuff I've ever seen." That was when I learned the great lesson about Washington, D.C. Hello, Tony. Oh, yeah, just wave. That's all you have to do. That's good on. That's good for the people just hearing the audio
only. How
are
you doing? I'm sorry. I don't want to interrupt.
Yeah, but...
I think an appropriate song for that, aside from the Babyface thing, but for your adventures in Washington, would have been that I can't remember the group, but "Smile to Your Face All the Time They Want to Take Your Place."
The Backstabbers, the OJs, yeah,
OJs, yeah.
Well, it was a marvelous day because I for the first time in my life had the ability to speak to my government directly, you know, and there were people up there who were paid to listen to me. They weren't paid to act properly, but they were paid to listen to me. And so it made it for a wonderful day. And somewhere I still have the congressional record with my testimony in it. So, you know, we had some great adventures, you and I, John.
Mr. Bennett goes to Washington, right?
Oh yeah, it was we
pretty
we,
much.
That
oh,
was
yeah.
That was a real adventure. It really
well,
was.
That show is one of those things where after a while we figured out the way to because the cable company, the especially there were two different ones, Lower Manhattan and Upper Manhattan. Upper Manhattan, basically the teleprompter people, I think they were called, really didn't, you know, I'm pretty much everything we sent up there was fine, but the copies that we'd send to what was Manhattan Cable?
We had to get them to them like days earlier so they could watch them. And
right. And they would say, well, you know, could you cut this out, cut that out or something? We don't, you know. And for a while we were, if there was something they didn't like, we would put up a, you know, you could still hear the audio, but you put up on the video, a screen just saying, you know, this has been taken and, you know, censored by because of, you know,
they didn't like it. They didn't like
us doing
that,
this number.
But we did it. We did exactly that. We said, this is being censored by Manhattan Cable. If you don't like it, be sure to get a hold of them. Here's their phone number. Right. And that would go over the offending moments. And the reason we did that, if you may remember, is in those days, it wasn't like today where you've got, you know, you've got a computer and you lay down all your video and stuff and then you just move it around.
Oh,
you know,
tape.
In those days, if they said, take this out, this 10 seconds out, you could do it just without even thinking about it. But in those days, you were doing a piece and then laying down another piece and another piece and another piece. So if you had to go back and re-edit, you had to start at the beginning and do it all over again. And so the easiest way for us was to just insert over the offending part, you know.
Yeah, a slide, basically, and just say.
A slide.
But I think we got to the point where you know, we would figure that the best way to get some of this stuff through, the more outrageous stuff, is to have a show that's relatively tame, except you have one really outrageous thing, and they'd be okay with that. Like I think the one I'm thinking of was another one. It was the gay bathhouse on the East Side Sauna, I think it was. And it was a rather classy place, but it had naked guys walking around and standing around and that sort of thing.
I'm trying to remember. We did a thing with Marilyn Chambers and a black male dancer, and he was totally nude, and she, of course, was totally nude, and they were just dancing. That's all they were doing. There was no sex involved or anything. They were dancing. The tape. They send the tape back. They go, "We can't have that guy, the black guy, dancing." They said, "Why?" Said, "Because his penis is bobbing up and down."
Well, and, that's what and, I was
and
leading
I, and
into.
I, and I,
you know,
yeah.
was you figured out ways you would
edit
out some
of that. What happened
was,
is I argued with them that to say that Marilyn Chambers wasn't equally as obscene is just sexist because she doesn't have an appendage that can bounce up and down, you know, or her boobs, but that's not a genitalia. And I said, you're making a distinction between the male dancing and the female dancing, and you shouldn't. That's wrong. But they didn't buy it, so the thing never ran.
Yeah. I'm not sure you'd remember this, but I think when I started editing, we'd have to edit that out. I called it the "It Ain't the Meat, It's the Motion" school of editing. Because the sauna people, the guys in the gay bathhouse, as long as they were standing still, no problem. They could be naked. They could look like statues. If they started jumping around or dancing or something, forget it.
Well, if you jump up and down and you're naked and you're a male and you have at least a decent sized penis, it's going to bob up and down.
Right.
Okay?
Such is gravity.
And what I today, if I argued that, and they would immediately let me put it on. Because they don't want to have that sexist thing put on them, that they're making a distinction between the female body and the male body, you know.
So. And why were they so worried about a black male body?
We don't want to get racist either. Yeah, and it was a black male dancing with a white female.
Oh, there we go.
Yeah, and this was 1976?
Probably 75 or 6, yeah.
Yeah.
It was a little before me, I think, but...
Yeah.
I came in a little later than some of the other folks, the David and Jim and some of those guys that I knew that started working, then I started working there, you know.
By the way, let me mention,
I had the car. I had the transpiration.
Let me mention, I heard from Patrick today. And it seems like Patrick is not going to be operated on because the nurse, the person was going to do the operating, or the anesthesiologist was not happy with the blood work because they'd used blood thinners on him. So he has to go back now and not use blood thinners, and then they'll go in and do this little operation.
Mm. They can do anesthesiologists can shut you down if they're worried that you're going to have problems recovering from, you know, whatever they give you.
Yeah.
Somebody I know, that same thing, that they thought he was going to do it, and, you know, they said, no, I don't like the way you're set up here. You gotta do it later.
Yeah.
It's weird.
And let me see here. Did I get another message here? What is this other message here that I had. I don't have it here.
Right. I had my medical thing.
Okay,
today,
Jeff wrote me this note. I want you to hear it. I don't know if Jeff's going to call tonight, but you may remember last night, Jeff, who's one of my favorite callers, I think one of all of our favorite callers, we love the guy, he fell asleep while the show was on.
I missed that.
You know, well, he wrote me a note today, and he said, I'm sorry that, in fact, when we ended the show, he was still sleeping. I mean, I don't know what happened when he woke up and saw that there was nothing on the screen.
Would have been good programming if Jack wasn't on after, just to leave that on and go to sleep.
Yeah.
Just you go to sleep and leave GabNet up.
Yeah, I should have left GabNet up just with him sleeping all night.
Yeah.
But anyway, he says, I'm sorry I fell asleep last night. I've been taking a temporary medication that prevents arrhythmia, fluttering, and clotting. It makes me a bit loopy. Of course. Yeah. I went to the gym in the morning. After Friday, I go back on baby aspirin and back to Abby normal, as he put it. But if you're listening to us right now, Jeff, I would love to hear from you, and we can then give you a fun time about falling asleep on the show.
If you're awake.
But don't feel guilty about it, you know. I don't want you to forego your medicine so you can stay awake for this debacle. Rob, do you ever watch Midnight Blue in New York? No. Is that before your time?
I didn't live in Manhattan. I knew of it. Yeah. I'd seen a couple of episodes. I think it was Sterling Manhattan Cable it ran on.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Well, it started on Sterling Manhattan, and then it became Manhattan Cable when Time Life bought it, which later became Time Warner, obviously.
Yeah, I had a friend who lived there, and I got to see it a couple of times at his apartment. But other than that, you know, I lived on the island, and Chuck Dolan wasn't going to run it.
Chuck Dolan was, what was he?
Cablevision.
He was Cablevision. Yeah, they weren't going to run Midnight Blue.
No.
At one point, we tried to syndicate it, but it was very hard. You know, in those days, I mean, what we were doing, if I were to show you Midnight Blue today, you would go, boy, that's tame. Mm-hmm. But for its time, everybody was like sweating bullets, you know? Oh, if you see what these guys are getting away with, you know, I mean,
as I said, people who had video records would record it and send it off to. Wasn't there a story that somebody sent a tape of it to Groucho Marx and he thought it was hilarious? I don't know why, but I remember hearing that.
I don't remember hearing.
You're kidding,
I don't.
You had to have money to have or at least something to have.
I would like to know that Groucho had said, like, that's the nastiest thing I've ever seen.
Exactly. You know? He probably. But this was, I mean, I don't remember. There were rumors that tapes were being sent around by various people. As I said, like guys from Channel 7 or something were sending them out to, because they had access to be able to copy, to make a tape, you know, record off the air. I lived in Brooklyn. I couldn't see a thing. You know, they didn't even have cable in Brooklyn until the late 80s, I think.
Yeah. Well, you know, we used as a theme song for Midnight Blue, the song, They're Playing Our Song, which was the title song from the Broadway show, They're Playing Our Song. And we were then given the notification that maybe we can't use that because it's in copyright, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I know what happened, but that wasn't what happened. What happened was I got some kind of, not note from, but somebody who was in his office who called me for Marvin Hamlisch and said, I'm calling on behalf of Marvin Hamlisch. And I thought to myself, here we go, cease and desist, right? She said, Marvin so loves you using that song on Midnight Blue, he gives you complete permission to use it into perpetuity. And that was my moment with Marvin Hamlisch. Never met the guy or anything, but he loved the show. He loved the fact that his song was being used as the theme on the show. So
Pittsburgh connection there, too.
Huh?
The Pittsburgh connection there, too, Marvin Hamlisch.
What do you mean Pittsburgh connection?
If that's the same person I'm thinking of.
Marvin Hamlisch, the songwriter?
Composer, the songwriter.
I don't think he's from Pittsburgh. He's from New York.
But he's worked in Pittsburgh for years as part of the Pittsburgh Symphony Orchestra.
No. Marvin's dead.
He is dead. He's been dead.
Did Marvin Hamlisch ever work with the Pittsburgh Symphony Orchestra? I don't think so.
This is the same guy that did the disco rendition of the James Bond theme song, right?
He wrote one of the James Bond theme songs.
There's this Pittsburgh connection there with him.
I think nobody does it better, maybe.
Disco Bond, I think, is what it was. The theme song, the traditional theme song set to a disco.
No, that wasn't that Marvin Hamlisch. Marvin wrote a lot of songs in his time.
He's a composer and a conductor.
Yeah.
Yeah, composed.
If you start naming,
he did, and he held positions as the pops conductor for the Pittsburgh Symphony Orchestra, Milwaukee, San Diego,
okay,
Seattle, Dallas, Buffalo, National Symphony Orchestra.
Okay, so that's maybe where you get the Pittsburgh connection, Brian. Mm-hmm. And he also, he wrote some Broadway shows, including a chorus line. People forget that he wrote a chorus line. Very talented guy.
And we used a lot of music on that show without any permission.
Well, in those days, you just did. You could. In fact, I was using music on stuff up into the 90s, I think, before they started with this Digital Millennium Copyright Act. And now if you even hum it, you're in trouble, you know. So, I mean, today, Marvin Hamlisch would never... He couldn't even okay it. You know, I couldn't do it, period.
We always tried to find songs that would fit, usually in a funny way, whatever was being done. I know you had one of the things you allowed me to do was book reviews.
Uh-huh.
And basically I grabbed some of the books that Al Goldstein was using to review in Screw magazine.
Yeah.
And if they were, like, some of them were photo books, with, oh, this is perfect for video. Remember there was one called Asses. It was a coffee table book of photographs by various photographers of people's backsides.
Oh, today that would just otherwise. Be various photographers' pictures of Donald Trump. But anyway, go ahead.
Yeah, right. Exactly. Exactly.
Especially with Photoshop, but, superimpose a face on it.
So there. You know, so come we figured, well, that's got a good visual appeal to it. So I wrote something stupid about it, but showing and did a photo montage of these various shots, zooming in, zooming out of all these things. To James Taylor's "Whenever I See Your Smiling Face," close enough.
Well, we had a thing we did called a visit to Mistress Roseanne, and it was about this maitress, right? And literally, she had this guy hanging up and was beating the shit out of him. And somehow I said, you know, if I just have a shot of her hitting this guy repeatedly, it's just going to seem brutal. So instead, I put music behind it, and I put Ringo Starr singing, "You Always Hurt the One You Love." And somehow it worked. Somehow it worked.
Yeah, the opposite one on that was, and I love this one. I actually wrote, I don't know if I sent it to you yet, Alex, but I wrote a short story sort of based around Roseanne and the guys who did the sex fantasy theater. The guy was about 500 pounds. And the little slave girl would say, yes, my mistress, whatever. It was, they were trying to do this very dramatic S&M thing, and they were awful. They were hilarious. We were all trying to keep from laughing. And then Alex said, you know, John, I know what I want to do. I'm going to edit this. I'm like, oh no, you know, whatever. And you basically played it straight. But you put Bernard Herrmann psycho music to this. I mean, really intense. Whatever. This guy who's about 500 pounds, I think he had a diaper on or something like that was being hit. And you know that he couldn't feel it.
I can't remember that one, but I do remember there was a.
But they loved it. They came and saw it. I thought they were going to hate it. They thought it was great.
An S&M theater group.
Yeah.
And they were doing fantasies that people have, and one was a woman who wanted to be a chicken. And so we went down to a place where they had all these chickens they were getting ready to chop the heads off of and shot the chickens and then did this whole thing with a guy as a chicken. That was it.
Yeah, and, that was the other. That was the more interesting one, though. Those guys, they were fun.
And a woman, you know, chastising the chicken, so to speak. I think he's dead.
A lot of things about plucking him.
I think he's dead, but there was a guy who was a talk show host, conservative talk show host in New York City, and his name was Barry Farber.
Oh, yeah.
I think he may still be around, because he used to be a client of my old studio, he's looking really ancient now, but yeah, I think
I'm not going to put him down for that, but here's the thing. Here's the thing about Barry.
Yeah.
He was into this stuff.
The chickens?
And so he came up to my apartment, and we showed him the stuff we had done with this theater group, and he loved it. He was just crazy about it. And then he'd go back on the air and go, how can you do this kind of stuff? This is horrible, this sex stuff. Blah, blah, blah.
Well, he knew the woman. I mean, it was like, Leal was her name. She was
Leal Lowndes.
Lowndes, yeah. Chip and Leal. Chip was the guy, and they were it was really... It was hilarious. It really was.
They did
two or three different scenarios, but the chicken one definitely was, you know, was the funniest.
Tell them some of the sexual tableaus you edited for Rod Swenson and Wendy O. Williams.
They were pretty weird, too.
My favorite mm-hmm. was the one where he videotaped Wendy O. Williams and another woman having sex with each other in 100 pounds of peanut butter.
I forgot about that one.
Did you remember?
I don't like peanut butter. Maybe that's why.
You probably are allergic.
I don't know if I edited that one or not. Did you edit that one? I don't remember editing the peanut butter.
I did some of his stuff.
I remember Wendy in a Girl Scout uniform at one point, but that was, and boy, she didn't look like a Girl Scout, any Girl Scout you'd ever seen.
Yeah, well, they would come up and they would edit, and it'd be like 11 o'clock in the evening, and Wendy would say, "Well, I've got to go now," and somebody would walk her down to the street to get her a cab, and cabs would literally careen into her because of the outfit she was wearing that time of night on 14th Street.
I think that's true.
And yet this was one of the sweetest women I've ever known.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I used to, when I was...
John was a plasmatic, ladies and gentlemen.
I was the fifth plasmatic, like the fifth Beatle. Behind the scenes, mostly as a roadie, but they also... There were times when you needed an extra person on stage to make sure that the chainsaw was plugged in, or you know, for when Wendy decided to cut through a guitar or whatever, and somebody had to step out of the coffin with a violin and scrape away at the end there and all that. And that, so I was sort of the go-to utility yeah. background person yeah. on that. Yeah. But also, I mean, the main reason we did rock videos of three or four of those songs, and we would then I would set up, video monitors up at like in CBGBs, hanging them from the wind from the ceiling and all that, and we would start the show with a couple of the things as videos. Showing the videos of the of the songs, which as I said, this was like 79, so it was really before around MTV time, and then they'd start the actual program. Mm-hmm. So, yeah. That was interesting. I mean,
great times.
Oh yeah.
By the way, we've been joined by Jeff Stein. Hello, Jeff.
Hey. Good evening.
Yes, if you can turn on your camera so we can see you, and we can see when you fall asleep. Okay.
Looks just, awake in that picture.
Yeah, there he is.
Oh, there he is.
There he is. Let me see here. First of all, I just want to check something because I want to see if there's anybody listening to us on the audio side. Oh wow, a lot of people tonight. Wow. I guess we got to talk about sex more often.
There you go.
You know that always gets them. That always gets them. Anyway, Jeff, last night. We weren't even really making fun of you. We just found it amusing that I went and asked you a question, and you didn't move.
No answer.
No answer. And all of a sudden, somebody went, "He's asleep." Now, when you slept, it was kind of nice because it wasn't like it was obtrusive. I know that Charlene always used to fall asleep because she had apnea. She'd fall asleep during the show, but she'd start snoring. Mm. You know, and then we'd all have to yell. Charlene, wake up. But I was telling people, shh, let him sleep. You know, he needs it. So you explain why you fell asleep. We certainly didn't mind it, you know.
Well, yeah, I brought you a little note. But anyway, I've had some arrhythmia over the years. Mm-hmm. And I started having some fluttering about a couple of weeks ago. So I went to... doctor sent me to the hospital, and actually I got this electrical thing, and she says, you know, you ought to take some different medications for a while. And normally I took like a baby aspirin.
Yeah.
So she gave me some drug that I had never taken before, and oh my God, it made me loopy. You know, like sometimes I was tired, sometimes I was... a little bit lost,
I don't like it when doctors do that because it's almost like they have an attitude, oh well, we can give him the heavy stuff because he's old. You know, really, I mean,
he doesn't have anywhere to go.
I find with my doctor, I went to him, I said, he says, what drugs do you need? He said, well, I need another script for Xanax because that's a one-time thing, right? And I said, how about Lunesta? That's another one-time thing. He said, okay, fine. Anything else? And I'm thinking, I'm just going to test him and say, how about heroin?
Nice.
And he probably would have written it down on the script pad. Heroin. What's close to heroin? What do we have here? Darvocet. Yeah.
Do I take that in the morning or at night?
Yeah. Take it twice a day. You know, and the contradictions on the side are, may cause death. Anyway, but... they will give you a drug like that because he's old, he doesn't have to go to work, you know, he gets loopy, you know. But if you were younger, I think they'd be a little more careful about what they gave you.
Could have been. The other thing is, I checked my heart this morning.
Yeah,
and
it was still there.
I'm still there. That the rhythm is appropriate.
Yeah.
And they can check that from my house on the radio. On the telephone.
Yeah.
So anyway, it seems it's work, and they said, and you can stop taking that drug. And I said, thank you.
Oh yeah, you seem a lot more awake than you have been the last couple of nights.
It's something that really knocks you out for a little bit, even though I don't mean obviously what happened last night, but every day you're a little bit.
Well, I think
out of sense.
Yeah, I don't like to do drugs that, you know, sometimes I find now I'm having to take Xanax about every other night to go to sleep because I want to get to sleep when I want to get to sleep. I don't want to lie there and toss and turn and toss and turn. And yet I don't want to really be reliant on any drug like that. But, you know, sometimes as you get older, somebody said, yeah, you know, as you get older, it's harder for you to go to sleep, you know, except for you last night. That was really easy for you. Here's the one I don't get with girlfriend and her. She will fall asleep. Middle of the night, I go in there to go to sleep, 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock in the morning. I tippy-toe around the room. And sometimes I will just tippy-toe over to the fan to turn it down a notch because she's got it on turbo, right? Mm-hmm. And it's kind of cold in there to begin with. And I'll just sneak over and just quietly tap the thing, and she wakes up and goes, what are you doing? You know, or I will take my pillow and I will put it on the floor, and she says, why did you drop that? And it just wake up. Now, on the other hand, here's a TV show she wants to see. Let's say it's, I don't know, Fargo or some show she really likes. Within 5 minutes, she's asleep. And I keep telling her, you're asleep. And she's, no, I'm not. She never will admit it. But she can go to sleep during something she really likes. But she can't, she will wake up if I drop a pin in the room. So, you know, and she takes Xanax and a couple other things to put her to sleep every night. You'd think she'd be out like a light. You know, it's just that I don't like drugs that disable me. And I feel that, for instance, Xanax, to a certain extent, makes me a little, if I'm off it for a couple of days, I'm a lot sharper than if I, the day after I had taken it to go to sleep. So I know how you feel about that, you know, a drug like that, you know, if you can live without it and you do okay, that's fine. Oh, here comes Renee.
But it's true. When you get older, I find like I don't sleep as much anymore. Like I don't need so many hours.
Well, I've always been this type that feels he needs 8 hours sleep a night. And so if I don't feel I'm getting my 8 hours, you know, it bothers me. You know. Hello, Renee.
Hi. Hi, everyone.
I'm not getting your picture yet, but don't worry about it.
Really?
Okay. Well, she'll try again.
It was there.
That's not her, by the way. The elephant is not her. And what the elephant has to do with you, I have no idea. Why do you have an elephant as your picture?
I took it when I was in South Africa.
Oh, I see. Okay. Because I don't know.
They were huge.
I don't know that's a Renee Collins photograph of an elephant. I just, you know, I thought you just got it out of the Encyclopedia Britannica.
Yeah, some of you smart-ass Republican men, none of you that I know of here, will start smarting off about how dare you have a picture of, what was the thing that someone killed and said, oh, the lion, so I see you have a picture of the lion from Kenya, and I'm like, no, jackass, I was in South Africa, I took the photo myself, it's a different lion. And those men go away and shut up so quickly because it's like they've never gone out of the United States. So when you say that you went to South Africa or you took this in Australia or you took this over here, then they shut their mouths up because that's what they think. They think that you've gone onto somebody's website and taken the photo off.
Wow.
No. I went and got it.
Yeah. It looks. It's. I just wondered why it was always the elephant there. What the, you know? Yep. Now that I see that you took the picture.
Well, so for Rob, the thing I'm going to do coming up soon is I'm going to put my colonoscopy innards on.
Oh, come on! You're copying me. I did that already.
I know, but I thought if everybody put some sort of insides on their Skype page, that Rob will get the hint. So my question is, Jeff, do you have an inside of your picture of your heart or your valves?
Oh, yeah.
So everybody needs to.
You know something? That's not a bad idea for a website. I wonder if anybody's doing it. Maybe I'll do it. Just send us your pictures of your colonoscopies, your cystoscopies, your, you know, all the photographs they've taken of insides of people.
Yeah. And so I thought I would just change.
And we'll call it like Inside America.
I have a good picture, but it's not inside.
That could be a very scary thing.
What? What were you going to say, Brian?
Americans.
Oh, I said that could be inside of America. That could be a very scary thing.
Yeah, absolutely. Gee, Renee, you're still whirling around.
I shouldn't be.
Yeah, no, but you are. Are anybody else seeing her?
She's whirling around to me, too.
No, I've got an icon. I don't even have an elephant.
Yeah. Well, just keep the elephant up, Renee, if we don't get a picture on you, because then at least.
Is that better? Or your elephant still?
No, you're whirling around like it wants a picture, but it's not grabbing.
Okay.
You know.
So yeah. Jeff, when you had fallen asleep, they were trying to talk to you. They actually didn't even know you were asleep. They were waiting for Jeff to give us his word and his blessing on what, and we're all like, oh yeah, he's not talking to us. He's just. waiting for you. It was very cute.
We were very happy to see that you were moving every now and then, because we were worried that, you know, we never know.
Cute.
You know,
it was really cute, because it was like we're asking him questions, and we're waiting for him to speak, and it's not happening.
Yeah. Well,
it was cute. By
the end of the show, today I was watching the show on my big 65-inch TV set, which it looks great now because the new system we use here puts out with a really nice, clean picture. And there you could really see you sleeping.
Oh, boy.
Yeah.
Well, actually, I took a look at it this morning.
Oh, did you really?
Yeah, and I said, I wonder if, because I wasn't quite sure.
Stuff.
And I said, oh my God, I was really.
I'm not. I'm surprised it doesn't happen more often on this show.
Yeah.
Because some people call up, you know, and they like, you know, Tony doesn't say a lot, but he listens to what's going on. And Scott listens
a
lot.
A little.
The great thing about Scott is when there's nobody else around, he'll chatter my ear off and keep the show going. And then when other people join in, he just backs off, you know. But
for a lot of people, it's a 3-hour, or for Renee, what is it, a 5-hour difference?
Oh, well, the sun is still shining sometimes,
right,
by the time she's listening to us. Is the sun shining right now, Renee?
Yeah, absolutely. It's light outside.
Yeah, yeah.
You want me to take you outside?
Well, we can't see you because
you can't. So you didn't see me just.
Why don't you hang up and call back again? Why don't you just hang up and call back again? Let's see if maybe that, you know. Because it would be nice to see Hawaii, pictures of Hawaii, if we could. But we'll wait and see. Here she comes. Now it's trying again. And there she is. See, it worked. That worked. That worked.
You want to go outside? Does everybody want to take a spin around the deck?
Let's take a spin outside. Hold on a second. Let me make the screen full screen there so that people watching out there can see it. She's in Hawaii, ladies and gentlemen. There's her dog. And we're going outside. Look at that. The sun is starting to go down, isn't it?
Yep.
Yeah, look at that. Oh, isn't that beautiful?
That looks nice.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
It's like the diametrically opposed opposite of what's outside Tony's window.
Because I got my alarm system coming Saturday.
You know, I remember when I was a kid. The biggest day on television was there was a show on Sunday, and I'm trying to remember what the name of it was. It might have been Omnibus, or it might have been one other show. And they made a big deal out of the fact that they were going to have a picture coming from New York and a picture coming from, I think it was, San Francisco. And they were going to be on the same screen at the same time, and it was the first time, coast to coast live, and it was the first time that had ever happened because they had just opened up the coaxial cable that went across the country. And how amazed we were by that. And now when somebody calls us up like Renee and she's got a picture of Hawaii, we go, that's nice. You know, it's not amazing, though. It's just she's in Hawaii and she's showing this to us.
The other night I was watching Saturday Night Live,
and
Jimmy Fallon was hosting. And Jimmy said it was the first time Saturday Night Live was ever broadcast coast to coast live.
Yeah, they have started broadcasting it live. across the whole country at the same time.
Yeah, I didn't know that.
So that in California, it goes on at 8:30.
Oh, that's early for SNL, man. That's weird.
That's 8:30.
You would think that they wouldn't get away with it because the humor that they run at 11:30 at night. In fact, NBC reruns the old Saturday Night Live, they put a little disclaimer up saying that this comedy was originally on at 11:30 at night.
Yeah.
But it's a little heavy. So 8:30 at night is a weird time for SNL.
Yeah. Okay, Renee, I'm going to go back to putting everybody up full screen here, but I wanted people to be able to see you in that beautiful Hawaiian sunset that was going on there. Very nice. Very nice. What are you pointing at?
Well, there were kayakers, ocean kayakers right there. Well, first off,
we
can't hear you.
Oh, really? That's weird.
Oh, you were covering your microphone.
So right over there, down there, there were a couple of ocean kayaks, and they should be coming out somewhere about here.
Yeah.
So wait, there's one. Can you see him in between the trees?
Well, here we go. I have to go full screen now. Yeah, it's hard to see because there's a little problem with it being blurry. And the other problem is that the sun is coming. It's trying to compensate for the sun, and so it gets dark.
Now you can have full sun.
Yeah. There. See how dark it is?
That looks like
okay, let me put everybody back up here. And damn. There we go.
And then for you Sarah Palin types, that's Japan.
That's Japan. Okay. We have maybe as the summer goes on, we get some great sunsets of the courtesy of Renee. So it's really
got
nice.
Three kayakers.
Yeah.
Was it built free night?
What?
I'm sorry, what? Two questions at one time. Give me one at a time. Okay. Who first?
Well,
go ahead.
Maybe me.
Yeah.
Now, are you on Oahu or one of the other islands?
No, I'm on the Big Island with James Lee. Island.
Oh, okay, the Big Island. Okay.
Yep.
Now I have a good friend that lives just outside of Honolulu, and I keep wanting to go there so badly. It's just haven't been able to the time and money to go all the way from New York City.
Yeah, a lot of people, you know, it's strange. A lot of people who are in New York City never go to Hawaii because it's a long trip.
Californians do.
But Californians do because it's not a long
trip.
3 hours,
like somewhere. Yeah.
It's a little longer, isn't it?
You say that, but you would not believe how many Europeans we get here.
Really?
Mm-hmm. And
once they get going, yeah.
And they are more than willing to fly some buku hours just to get here.
Well, when I was a kid growing up in California, there were very few people who ever went to Europe.
Mm-hmm.
Because especially in those days when you didn't have the jets, you had the props and everything like that, it would take you forever to get to.
Painful.
Yeah. Now painful. It's, what is it? It's 5 hours to New York and then another, 4 hours, is it? Another 4 hours to get to Europe. So
yeah, Alex, did you say so I didn't get to listen to the first part of this because my phone wasn't charged. Did you say you were coming over here for Bubbles' show?
No, I can't. You know, to begin with, it's next Saturday.
Oh, okay.
It's funny. I did two shows with him today, two things with him today. So the next one will play next week. And on that one, I mentioned the show coming up, and I shouldn't have because it would be over with by the
It'll
time.
It'll be over by the time. Yeah.
But yeah.
Well, I donated. Is there any way I can give my tickets to Tom?
That I don't know. I have no idea about the free tickets. You know, because I obviously didn't. I'm not going.
Well, you're
so
not going to use yours.
I think. What's his name?
I'm sorry. I said Bubbles.
Senior moment.
Ruben.
Senior moment with our arch conservative on the program.
Phil Meyer.
Phil Meyer. Phil Meyer is going and taking advantage of the free ticket. You know,
of course he is.
Because he gave like $100. But he was handling me. Can you get an okay from Rube for me to take pictures while it's going on? And I had Rube today, and he was so just off the deep end. In fact, we did our interview late because he didn't wake up in time for it. Because this whole thing is a real stress for him. And I just didn't want to hit him up. Can this guy come take photographs? And to me, the answer would be no, because they're shooting video. Mm-hmm. And they don't need somebody sitting around clicking a shutter on a camera. So I didn't. So maybe that's why Phil hasn't called me tonight. Or
just tell him no.
Yeah, well, that's what I said. I said I usually feel uncomfortable asking for those things anyway. You know.
Yeah, it would just be nice to give. I mean, Tom does a lot. I mean, yeah, you have tickets. I mean,
well, you know what you could do. You could call over to what's it, lab? What's it called? Something lab. And it's the old Anne's 440 in San Francisco. I don't know how everybody's going to fit in there. It's not the biggest club in the world, you know. But anyway, he's going to do the show there, and you could ask them. Or I could call.
Yeah, Ruben. There were so many of us that probably aren't going to go. I figured, yeah, let's see if we can get Tom something.
Well, I didn't stop to think that it was this Saturday, but I wished him my best and. Told them.
Well, okay, so two things. One, Mother's Day is coming up.
Mm-hmm.
And number two, I think it's 1 month from today is Memorial Day or something like that.
Pretty close, yeah.
Yeah. So what are you asking?
Not asking, just reminding.
Oh, really? Well, let's see. Memorial Day, yeah. And Mother's Day. Well, I always used to do a whole bit about Mother's Day. You know, once my mother died, how dare you say this to me? You know, how dare you rub my dead mother's memory in my face by saying it's Mother's Day, because I don't have a mother to give anything to. And my father died even years earlier than that. I don't have a father. I'm an orphan. What do you do with this Father's Day and this Mother's Day thing? And, you know, it's a big bunch of shit anyway. It was invented by a bunch of, you know, greeting card companies.
Well, the lady that founded it, from what I understand, there was a woman who founded Mother's Day, and then when she realized in her lifetime that it was becoming so commercialized, she was, like, distraught and almost suicidal.
Well, what? What were you going to say, Tony?
I usually get my mother scratch tickets. I get a win for life, but I told her if she wins, I'll still give her the money, but I'm going to live more.
That really shows you care, Tony.
So I'm going to buy some tickets if I don't get her. I'll get her tickets.
Get her some scratch tickets. Yeah, happy.
That's what I do.
No, but what do we do? We give women flowers, which die very fast. You know, they die. You know, if you gave them something that perpetually was around for a while, but they die, and chocolate so they can get fat.
Well, my mother likes candy. I get her like something, yeah.
You got to have flowers.
Oh, really?
Got to have flowers. Yeah, well, definitely.
Flowers are always nice, whether it's Mother's Day or whatever, you know.
I got my mother, one year I got my mother for Mother's Day tulips, right?
Love
and
tulips.
So I had them delivered, and when she opened the box, it was just the bulbs.
Oh,
flowers.
I sent her a message.
I didn't realize I sent her bulbs. I thought I sent her flowers.
Well, you remember that flowers by mail thing that, you know, they had. It was serious. They were advertising them. And I had to stop advertising them because they would always send flowers to us before we did the promotion so that we'd see how lovely these bouquets of flowers were. And every time I got them, they were dead. You know, somehow flowers by mail, not the best idea in the world.
Well, what they've been doing actually is they take the, so if you're on the West Coast, they try to use a West Coast grower to send them off to there. So they're at least semi-fresh. If you're on the East Coast, they try to use the East Coast growers to send them off through there. So it's a little bit better now because they're using a more of a United States kind of distribution idea.
Yeah.
But before, that's not how they did it.
Right. Right.
Well, the original FTD flowers thing back in the 60s, 70s, 80s, basically just connected with local florists.
That's essentially what happened. Yeah. You would order them.
Yeah,
and
you'd get something from a local florist, but you could call in from anywhere.
No, but these guys who send you the flowers, they actually just send them all from one place. And they came to me and they were dead. Or if they weren't dead that day when I got them, the next day they were. Jeff, you raised your hand.
Yeah, I used to work on 28th Street.
Yeah.
Where, I don't know if it still is, a flower section. Of New York, right? And so I'm coming down, and there's all these guys, and they're kind of like working on the street, and you know, people are loading up stuff, taking it away, buying it, selling it. Yeah. And I see a guy with a spray can changing the colors.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah.
Listen, you want me to tell you the sleaziest thing I ever had, the sleaziest job I ever had?
That's a pretty weird one.
In fact, it was a Krug flower shop in San Francisco, and the son of Mr. Krug was a friend of the family, and so they gave me a job working at the flower shop. And what my job to do was to take my car and go out to all the to various cemeteries. And
no.
Yes,
swipe the flowers
that they had put on the graves there, you know, and bring them back to the store so they could freshen them up and resell them.
Oh man,
that's funny.
Really?
I was for a short time getting paid to be a grave robber.
Nobody saw you do that, lifting all these flowers.
I think I had the truck for the store, and it just said the name of the store, and everybody went, "Oh, he's probably just cleaning up the mess they made from the flowers."
Yeah.
No, you know, we take him back, and he's there spraying them with water and slapping them on the face or something to wake them up, and then
he comes back twice and does his thing.
Yeah, he always said we can get at least two funerals out of one bouquet.
Oh, God.
Well, I think it was today on was like I was watching. I think it was probably Kathy Lee or one of those morning shows, and they were talking about a wedding planner that sets up a thing where basically, you know, they use the same flowers for two or three different weddings, and you get a better price, you know, than you know, as long as the flowers are, you know, around, because you only need them for a day.
That's
so right. You know, you know, she sets it up, and you just go from wedding to wedding,
from wedding to wedding,
yeah. And it's cheaper than getting all of them yourself.
I would think at one of those venues that have weddings all the time, that what they would do is just get the flowers for the day, and then all the weddings that go circle through it just gives a percentage of the flowers and not have to buy their own flowers.
Yeah.
I think that's a great way to go, because it's ridiculous to buy flowers for six weddings and then have to find a place that's something to do with them and ugh.
Take them to hospitals and stuff like that.
Yeah. And usually if you go to a flower shop and there's another guy there, you just generally, I think Slayton said this, you can always go up to that guy and say, "So what did you do wrong?" Because the only time anybody ever buys flowers is when they did something wrong.
Man, so I missed this. I have to admit. And so this is kind of like, I knew where the San Jose Flower Mart was, and I knew where you could go in. And so we had fresh flowers at least 3 weeks out of four.
Really?
Yeah, because daffodils were always so pretty there. Tulips were always great. And you can get them at a reasonable price. You can't do that here, though.
You know who has good flowers, oddly enough? I will do this on some holiday of that sort. If I'm at the Costco and they have the flowers out there because it's the holiday, I buy a bouquet of flowers for girlfriend. And she always said to me, "Yeah, you shouldn't buy them at Costco. They'll die really fast." Last time we bought some, they lasted for like a week, and they bloomed out and everything. They don't have lousy flowers there. Yes, Jeff?
No, I always buy good stuff from them.
Yeah.
I don't know where those came from. My wife got those. But I bought some stuff from Costco just the other day, and they were great.
There are things that Costco has that are just terrific, and that's one of them. You know,
you got to make the obligatory joke that the roses come taped. They tape
tape two one dozens together.
Yeah.
Oh, I used to have a joke about the fact that Costco is thinking of opening up an adoption agency, but they can't figure out how to tape two kids together.
That's good, actually.
Do you know they did sell stuff for if you die?
Yes, they have caskets.
Caskets. And I said, what is it, a two-for-one deal?
Yeah, two-for-one deal. No, they actually have caskets, and they it's in their catalogs online.
Yeah.
You go online.
I actually was at somewhere where they had one.
Well, they might have had it there.
I don't think it was in Connecticut. It was maybe.
They maybe were displaying it and saying you can order.
I don't know. But
they say they will get it to you within one day. You know,
fresh.
Because to begin with, if you're Jewish, you have to be buried within 2 days. So, you know, we got to rush that up.
That's why you
but have to. I will allow myself to be buried in a Costco coffin if on the side it says Kirkland.
Well, what about the Pringles guy?
Huh?
The Pringles guy.
Oh, is this going to be a true story or is this going to be an urban legend?
You know, I heard he was buried in a Pringles can. Is that true or not?
I heard the same thing, but I don't know. That could be, you know.
It would be an obvious urban legend.
Yeah, that's true.
Right?
That would be a pretty good size Pringles can because that's a lot of ashes.
Well, I don't know how I'm going because girlfriend says if I go before her, she's going to cremate me. And I said, I don't know if I don't know if I want to be cremated or not.
You'll never know.
That's my method of choice.
That's your method of choice.
It's my method, too.
Well, the thing is, here's why I don't want that. What happened to her parents' ashes? Well, she took some of them and scattered them, I don't know, somewhere. But the rest of them, she put in her storage locker in New Jersey. And then a while back, she just gave up the storage locker in New Jersey and said, I'm just not paying anymore. Go sell all the stuff, right? And I think the ashes were still in there.
Oh, and she good episode of Storage Wars.
She didn't care. Well, on the show just before us, Damien was talking because, you know, he works. He runs a storage facility. He said that a lot of times people have ashes there and then they don't pay their bill and we've got to throw the ashes out. You know, then they come to us crying, oh, I got to get the ashes and whatever. He says, never put your ashes in a storage locker. Never.
Don't you have like six
rooms? But I'm afraid she'll put me in a storage locker somewhere.
Imagine he's in a locker in Jersey.
Come back as some kind of ash golem seeking revenge or some shit.
Right.
Scott, you're pretty religious. How are you going?
I'm not going to go.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
I'm not planning on going either, Scott.
Narcissistic much.
Right. But, you know, I don't want to talk about the afterlife.
Yes,
it'll depress me. Mainly because it's coming closer and closer every day.
Yeah.
There was a time. What?
Did you finish your mom's memorial stone?
No, I haven't done it yet.
We're going to do that. I'm calling your ass for that one.
Yeah, well, I got to be able to afford it. I don't know. The price keeps going up. Who just called us on the phone? Who is this on the phone? Is it anybody that I want to talk to on the phone? If you don't say hello in a second, I'm getting rid of you. All right? I'm getting rid of you. Remove from group. There we go. Oh, and then it says, how'd you like the quality of this call?
Excellent.
Yeah, it was excellent. It was terrific. Best.
I didn't get the name here on that phone.
No, I feel guilty about that. That, you know, there's my father's tombstone, and you in fact sent me a picture of it.
Yeah, you know, we can do your mom's in three. I can do your mom's headstone with three questions. If you can answer those three questions, we can send it off to get it made.
Really?
Yeah.
And is it like Tombstones or Us? Is it cheap?
I don't know. I'll call and find out for you.
Yeah, because I'm sure if I bought it when she died, it would have cost 30 cents. But today it's going to cost $7,000.
No, it can't be that much.
No, actually, you know what? For Marty's, I spent a nice sum. But normally they're only around probably about $1,500 to $2,2500. That's not a lot.
It's still a lot of money for me at this point. You know, but
well, so your mom. So if you don't do it now, one of us is going to have to put your mom's headstone on her gravesite because we have to do it for you.
Okay. Anyway, here. But here's the thing. Here's the thing. I've often told this story, so let me tell the joke one more time. That my mother is buried next to my father, and she does not have a stone. So my feeling was is that I should take my father's stone off and then put one stone down to cover both of their graves that says, here lies Alex and Ruth Schwarzman, parents of, and then in big bold letters, Alex Bennett.
She's true.
Yeah. Huh? Huh? How's that? Huh? Mm-hmm.
You're a good Jewish. No.
By the way, it's interesting. I was at, there's a, can't remember where the place is, but we did it from one of my TV specials. We found the cemetery where Wyatt Earp is buried and his wife. And there's also a third person buried next to them.
Who is?
And I can't figure out who he was. I think maybe he was like a husband she married after Wyatt died.
I looked that up one time, and it wasn't a husband. It wasn't a husband.
It wasn't a husband.
Yeah. I don't know who it was, but it wasn't a husband.
But you could tell they were all buried together because they were in a cluster, so to speak.
And it
there's
wasn't
a story behind it. But I can't remember what it was now. I looked it up. It was on the internet.
And right behind Wyatt and I can't remember. I'm trying to remember her name now. I used to know her name very well. But right behind them is the big mausoleum for Levi Strauss. Mm-hmm. You know, so kind of a fascinating place. Jeff, we lost your picture. Oh, there
yeah,
we go.
Yeah, no,
going
I
back.
Yeah.
We lost there. It's kind of a very famous place. Most people don't know Wyatt Earp is buried in Redwood City, California. Mm-hmm. And I tried. There's a reason why, and I can't remember now.
I bet you they won't let you go near now.
Won't let us go near the grave now?
I probably
oh yes oh, of course
why not
yeah no you just go right you go to the cemetery and you find out where Wyatt Earp is buried and go look at it.
Wow.
Yeah, we stood there in the grave singing the Wyatt Earp theme song. Wyatt Earp brave, courageous and bold, long may he live, whatever. I can't remember the whole thing.
You got it. It was pretty, I remember that.
It was pretty close.
Sure. Hugh O'Brien played him.
Yep, that's correct.
Back in the 50s.
Now, do you realize we have gone the whole show and never really, except for one little passing joke reference, mentioned the word Trump?
Yay!
And you know why? Because guess who isn't here? You know.
And I didn't know it was a feel free day.
Yeah, it's a feel free day. It's a feel free A feel free that feels free. Well, yeah. Anyway, you get the picture.
It's been very enjoyable, too.
It has been, hasn't it? And the people, amount of people listening is quite large as well. So, you know.
They're waiting to hear more sex stories.
Yeah, no. They love those sex stories. Yeah. I want to ask Renee this, because this came up earlier about guys. You know, that so we were talking about Amy and how I think she's a female chauvinist pig. Okay. Yeah.
Amy Emanuel?
Yeah, because she's always putting guys down. You know, guys do this and guys do that.
Not heard me talk.
Well, no, but you
no,
know what I'm saying?
Go ahead. But, ask me the
but
question.
Let me ask you, because, you know, I claim that most guys are okay. You know, most guys are okay. There are some that, you know, because I've had women in my life who were terrible. And that doesn't make me a chauvinist towards women. But you had a very good marriage with a man you loved dearly. There was an example of a great guy.
Oh, yeah.
You know?
But you see, there's two things you have to look at being a female. One is the shit you're getting right at this moment just because you're a female and they would never have said all of those things to a male? And then you have to remember, most men would fuck mud. So,
well, my question to you, Renee, and I say this in all humbleness, my question to you is, what the hell is wrong with mud?
How warm is the mud?
Yeah. How warm is it? Warm? Is it consenting? Is it consenting mud?
Is it nubile mud? Yes.
Yeah. I'm sure it's nubile. So in response to your statement with Amy, no, she's fine. She's doing great. I think she stands on the right side of everything. Knowing the fact that half of these assholes would fuck mud, then yeah.
Well, now, let me explain why we'd fuck mud, okay?
For any reason?
Let's talk about, strip away the fact that we are human animals as opposed to other kinds of animals. But most animals, whether they're human or not, all have one prerogative, the males, and that is to inseminate the herd.
Yeah, we don't want
to. Okay? It is a natural biological imperative. Yet, it's a question of, if you're going to go out and inseminate the herd, do you do it with a great deal of decency and correctness, or are you going to be a pig about it? You know, and I think that most guys aren't really pigs.
No, see, I think it's the opposite way around. I think it's the opposite way around. It most men, look at Fox News, look at Roger Ailes, look at Bill O'Reilly. And now that there's a black man coming out saying that it was really shitty being a black guy there.
Well, here's where I take you to task, Renee, on that one. You're talking about a bunch of guys who had an incredible amount of power. Most guys don't have that kind of power. And so they act decently because they, you know, it's that kind of power that maybe made them act that way. Would Bill O'Reilly, if he had never become a big famous talk show host, been that big a pig?
Well, okay. You were talking about Saturday Night Live a little while ago. They just did a couple weeks ago, they just, right after the Women's March, they did a skit where the actors and actresses were sitting at a bar and the guy at the bar would always say the same thing, and it would be a different female each time. And the guy at the bar said, "But I marched in the women. Why won't you suck my dick? But I marched in the women's march. Why won't you give me a blowjob?" And each woman would sit down and say, "What? How do you get from A to B and think that it's our job to take care of the dick?"
You have a bunch of guys here, I think. In their romantic life over the years have been decent people. I think Rob's a very decent person, and I think he treats women decently. Haven't you, Rob?
Absolutely.
See? And John, I've known John for years. John is a very tender, very sweet person. I'm sure he never did anything untoward a woman. Anthony, of course, being the virgin of the group.
You know, see, that's one reason we should go to Rube's thing, is to fly Anthony out and get him laid.
Scott, I'm sure, is a sweet, wonderful guy. Brian, I have no idea what you're like with your lovers. But Jeff, you know, again, another great guy. So, and I'm actually been a pretty good guy over the years. I think I don't know of any women that could say something terrible about me in my relationships with them. Even my ex-wives I still talk to, you know?
That's true.
So I think guys are capable of being very nice and very good and very non-chauvinistic. And I think we get a bad rap. I really do.
I think there's not enough women out there that are raising children. And so the latest study said that women are trained to think that they are second to men starting around the age of 6. And as long as you're teaching little girls that men are better, that boys are better than them, mm-hmm. that early tells you what's happening in American families. That it's a ridiculous thing to tell me.
Of course, I can't say this experientially in my own life because I didn't have any sisters, so I don't know how they were raised, but how they would have been raised by my parents. But I think girls, when I was growing up, were kind of taught that you attach yourself to a man and then, you know, you live your lives together. But that was because it was a time when women didn't go out and get into the workforce.
This study was done within the past 2 years.
I'm doing this, I'm not because I'm Hitler, but because I feel like I'm going to sneeze. Hold on.
Yeah, by the age, women are trained to be submissive to men at the age of 6.
I think,
and if parents are still doing that shit.
I think that's an old concept. I think that that doesn't exist as much today as it did when I was growing up.
It's okay. Just not you know, we don't. Yeah, wait a minute. We don't have to
Jeff has his hand up, and we've got to get going here shortly. Yes, Jeff.
Well, Renee, I have four granddaughters, and they're from 14 down to 8 or something like that. I wouldn't give them. I wouldn't take your recognition here. I think they're all pretty independent people, and they don't defer to their father or to me or to their uncle or anything like that, other than a one-on-one personality.
Yeah. And I will finish off by saying that in no time in my life have I tried to tell. You know, do I feel that I can tell a woman what to do? Because I found out they won't. So, you know, it's...
Anyway. Yeah, go ahead. Tell us what to do. See how far that
yeah,
gets
yeah.
you.
Yeah, I'm not gonna fuck with you, Renee. That's for damn sure. Hey, thanks to all of you. John Rockwell. This has been a good show. It's been a lot of fun. Rob, a great crowd. Anthony, thank you. Renee, of course, you stir things up, you little minx, you. Scott Boddicker, thank you. And thank you in the beginning, because when I don't have anybody else here, you talk to me. You know? You don't just sit there quietly being submissive. Brian Ludwig, thank you so much. We'll get into your sex life and whether you're a good person to your lovers. But
fuck mud too?
Well,
what was that?
She said, do you fuck mud too? And Jeff, thank you so much as well. Everybody, have a good evening, okay? And thank you for joining us. Okay, everybody, that's it for our little program here. Let me get rid of the citizens panel so that the next people who are going to do a show here can use it as well. I'm Alex Bennett, and this has been The Ramble, and we will be back here again tomorrow night, same time, same station in life. Stay tuned for Amy and Jack on the intersection, and after that, Connections. And I'll see you again tomorrow night, same time, same station in life. In the meantime, if you see her, yeah, you know what to do. Tell her I love her, okay? Bye, everybody.